Welcome, student, to today's lecture on women and political process in the six assigned countries: USA, UK, Russia, China, France and Switzerland. Now, the specific objective of this module is to make you aware about women's political participation in these countries. Now, women's participation in the politics is today a debatable topic, and it's a very also a topic of hot discussion all around the world, because the UN is coming up with the various records and reports and data which show that the women are underrepresented in most of the countries, except the Nordic countries, which are doing quite well. And Rwanda, which is a very small African country, has the highest number of female representatives in the political system. Now, if we look at USA, you will see that recently there was a much hyped presidential election, and everybody expected that USA this time would have a female president, Hillary Clinton. But she, after her defeat, herself admitted that the glass ceiling could not be broken. And yes, US could have made a history, but the chance to make the history was missed, and Hillary could not become the president of the United States. But nevertheless, the picture is not so gloomy also, because if you look at the Congress and the Senate, you will find that 104 members of the Congress are the women. 20 of them are in the Senate, and the rest 84 in the House of Representatives. And the five inspiring women who are in the Senate, I must mention about them. They are Ilhan Omar, Kamala Harris, Pramila Jayapal, Tammy Duckworth, Catherine Mastor. And why these women are very inspiring, because each one, they have their own history. Most of them are children of immigrants, granddaughter of immigrants. Some are colored, some are refugees, Somali refugee, and some are Indian Americans, or to be more precise, South Asian women who have made their way into US politics. But still, a long way has to go, because researchers, they have found out that if 50% of the US Congress has to have female representation, they have stipulated that it can only be achieved around 2117, and that's a long way to go. The next country, UK. That's also very interesting, because in June 2016, you saw or the world saw that after this referendum on Brexit, which was a kind of unsuccessful story on the part of David Cameron, who cling on to European Union, and the people, the referendum, they voted against the Britain's continuance with the European Women, European Union. So David Cameron had to resign, and in his place we have Theresa May coming in as the female Prime Minister of Britain. And we all know that she is second, because earlier it was Margaret Thatcher who was the first woman or female Prime Minister of UK. And in Britain, there is a kind of wonderful kind of situation which people are appreciating. If you look at Westminster, we have Theresa May. If you look at Holyrood, that is Scotland, we have three women leading the top parties in Scotland. If you look at Wales, we have the first minister Wales, who is a woman. So everybody is talking that women are everywhere in England. So what is the then? Women must be very actively participating in politics in UK. But the fact is not that. The fact shows that things are not so rosy. Okay, the political participation is to some extent much better than the other countries. But compared to the Nordic countries, it is definitely not that high. But it has to, a long way has to go to establish female participation, whether it is in US or in UK, or further when we look into the other four countries. Everywhere women are coming up to participate, but again the number of women there who are coming to participate is not at all what is expected internationally. We know that China is controlled by Chinese Communist Party. We also know it's a kind of authoritarian regime. But we must also acknowledge that this Chinese Communist Party, it has tried to create an infrastructure through which it can encourage the women to come up and participate in politics. And for that, it has a female wing, which is known as All China Women's Federation, which tries to raise awareness among the women, tries to bring out of the kitchen into the outside world and tries to give them political training so that they can become future leaders and can participate in the political process. But alas, China is a very male dominated society. The male stereotypes or the gender stereotypes are present over there. Women are looked down. They are often identified with individuals having lack of confidence or they are not having the quality to govern. So the women are also always looked at as someone who can play a role inside the home rather than outside the home. And this is this is not so much different if we say in case of China. Rest of the world also, the women faces a dilemma where or which role is most suitable for the women, inside the home or outside. This dilemma is present everywhere, and this is the chief barrier which prevents the woman either herself from coming out or the society putting barriers before her and preventing her to come out into the outside world and participate in the political decision making and or even in actively participate in the politics. Now, France, we know, everybody, all of us are aware of French Revolution of 1789 and the Declaration of Rights of Man and of the Citizen that was adopted in 1789. France, which talks about equality, liberty, fraternity. What is the condition of women in France? Now, before looking into the present scenario, I must refer to one woman leader who was a playwright and an author, who had first vehemently criticized that Declaration of Rights of Man and of the Citizen. As a protest to the declaration, she wrote a declaration on the rights of woman and of the citizen. And this woman was Olympia though gorgeous. So in the country of Olympia though gorgeous, what is the condition of women? Women in France did not get their rights to vote or participate in the political process not before 1945. And then when they got the right, there was a kind of not much of participation in the political process. So we have here and there some women coming up and taking active interest in politics and also occupying political positions in the government. To mention very few women, we have Simone Veil, we have Francois Giraud, very few women who are coming up and occupying positions of importance. So what did the political system or the government, what did they do to increase the level of political participation by the women? So we find some French presidents like Mitterrand and later on others, they tried to rope in women and they tried to put them as ministers of health or ministers of women's issues, but still that was very little and the goal could not be reached and women remained underrepresented in France. So later, around in mid-90s, that's 1996, there were very powerful, some very vocal women who came up with the idea that women's representation, that is parity between male and female representation, that has to be established in the constitution. So likewise, the constitution was amended and a kind of quota system was introduced by such amendments. But again, the women groups and others, they had reservations against this quota system because they thought that it was inimical and also dishonoring the position of the women. But even after the quota system, we don't have that much of women's representatives. One good thing what happened during the last election, that is 2012 election, you have a good number of women suddenly coming up and occupying the legislative positions in the French political system. Now, in the French parliament, at present, you have almost around 155 female candidates. And this number has to go on. And we hope that France, being an European country, it will keep up its record and will try to ensure more and more women's participation in the politics. But one thing I must mention is that France also had a woman competing for the position of the president as an opponent or competitor of Nicolas Sarkozy, and she was Ségolène Royal. Obviously, of course, if she would have been the president, so we don't hear her name much, but misfortune, she did not have a good luck or misfortune, she lost the election to Nicolas Sarkozy. But nevertheless, we also, like Hillary Clinton, we had somebody in France also running for the presidential elections. Coming to Russia, what is the situation of Russia? Now, Russia is also another male-dominated society, though in papers, in constitution, the men and women, both of them are given equal political rights, etc., etc., everything. But again, women are relegated to a secondary position, and they are not so much looked up as promising candidates in the elections. So you don't have so much of women coming up and participating in active politics in Russia. But again, in the last 20 years, there has been a sea change, and you have a new generation of women coming up, and they can be dubbed as power women. Okay? And these women, they are doing quite well in politics, in business, in media, in market and communications, in a lot of fields. And I must mention the name of a few. Valentina, who is the chairperson of Russia's upper house of parliament, which is the Federation Council. And she also had another attribute because she governed St. Petersburg for 8 years. A female governor, St. Petersburg had a female governor for 8 years, from 2003 to 2011. Another influential woman in today's politics is Olga Golodets, who is the deputy prime minister. And we know Dmitry Medvedev is the prime minister, and so the deputy prime minister is a female. And also we have Natalia Timakova, who is the press secretary to Medvedev. So these are only a few. There is a long list. If you just go through internet sites, you'll find that there's a long list of power women. 10 power women. One list is gives you the power women who are in the business fields, and one list gives you the power women who are in the politics or in fields which are not so much business-like. So these 10 powerful women, they are coming up, and they are like examples to the other women, and we hope that Russia has more and more participation in the political process. But given Putin's kind of disencouragement towards women's participation, again there is a big question mark on how the women will be accommodated in the Russian politics. Now let us do the last country, that is Switzerland. I have deliberately kept Switzerland in the at the end of the discussion because this is a country which has a good record of women's representation in the political process. But again, Switzerland slipped down from the position. In 2015, according to the World Economic Forum, which comes up with the gender ratings or gender equality ratings, Switzerland occupied 8th position. But at present, currently at 2016, it is occupying the 11th position. So it slipped down quite a lot. Switzerland gave enfranchisement or the right to suffrage to the women in 1971, the last country the last country to give voting rights to the women. European, the last European country to mention precisely. But once this right was given to the women, we have laudable number of women participating in the mainline politics of Switzerland. 1971, when women franchise was introduced in Switzerland, the percentage of women was 5%. But in 2007, it was 30%. But in the last election of 2011, it came down a bit. But again, we must acknowledge that in Switzerland, the gender parity is much better than the rest of the countries that we have discussed. Because in Switzerland, we have the wage which the women and the man they enjoy are almost on a parity. It's 70%, and the Nordic countries, they have 78% parity between the wage between the men and the women. Literacy is, we all know, it's a the parity is also very high. So in Switzerland, the gender parity is high, but there is a small lacune which is again dragging the women behind. Now, what is that lacune? It's kind of electoral system, and in this electoral system, we don't have any quota system for the women. Women, they are suffering, and also the party will encourage a woman to compete when it is sure that this seat will be won by the party, and the party is sure that in that constituency or around the other constituencies it is assured of a comfortable number of seats, and so one seat or two seats can be given to spare to the women. So this attitude or this non-compromising attitude by the big parties are again holding the women back in Switzerland. But nevertheless, this is the country which is the best performing countries amongst the other five we have discussed. So overall, what we find is that either the political system is not doing its not doing a lot towards encouraging women's participation in the politics. On the other hand, there are problems with the women. They might not feel so comfortable with the politics. They might feel that home or doing daily course, they're more comfortable with that and they won't bother about the politics. Number three, which is most crucial, is the gender stereotype which is being created by the society, that women fit their role best inside the home and not outside. So the society might create barrier before the women which she might not be able to overcome and participate in the political decision making. So women have multifarious problem, and coping with this problem will only help women, or fighting this, struggling against these problems and overcoming these problems will only help women to come forward and actively participate in the politics, occupy positions and responsibilities in the government, and set examples to the future generation and break the glass ceiling, so that the next generation of women, girl child will feel that kind of enthusiasm and come forward and actively participate in the political process. Thank you.